All right, ADG, on two occasions, China and the Philippines have agreed to create a hotline, a direct line between high-ranking officials. First was during President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s state visit to China in January 2023, and second was during the recent BCM between the two countries. What happened to that hotline? Was that actually used this time around?
Well, first of all, the hotline that was established during the first visit of the president, state visit to Beijing, we tried calling them and there was no answer. No, but this hotline was revived during the last bilateral consultation mechanism. And during this meeting, a hotline was agreed upon by both parties for purposes of the resupply in Ayungin. So we have not tested the hotline yet, but the communications between the Chinese Coast Guard and the Philippine Coast Guard are ongoing. When the Ayungin resupply was conducted, the communications were okay. And on the level of our diplomats, the discussions are also robust. No? So, but insofar as the hotline is concerned, I'm not really sure if that hotline in the case of the aerial incident was utilized.
ADG, would it actually be fair to say that China has been frequently or consistently finding loopholes with regard to whatever what has already been agreed upon between Manila and Beijing?
First, we have to clarify to the public that the provisional agreement does not apply to Bao de Masinlo. The provisional agreement merely applies to Ayungin, to resupply missions by the Philippine government to BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal. So I think people are confused and are expecting that the result of the bilateral consultation mechanism applies to the entire West Philippine Sea. No, it does not. The BCM exchange of notes, or what is called as a preliminary understanding, was merely for Ayungin Shoal and for the orderly conduct of the resupply missions. Now, as to other parts of the West Philippine Sea, that's another issue altogether. So I think insofar as the BRP Sierra Madre resupply is concerned, both sides are complying with their obligations towards the preliminary understanding. But as to the other parts of the West Philippine Sea, that's another matter altogether.
Very quickly, what are those preliminary obligations agreed upon by the two countries?
Well, Katrina, as I mentioned also in other interviews, we cannot disclose the contents of the preliminary understanding because it is dependent on the approval of both sides to release it. So meaning we have to have approval from the PRC and from our side that we will release it to the public. We do not want to be accused by the PRC to be not complying with that provision of the preliminary understanding. But let me take this opportunity to clarify, number one, that there was no agreement on our part for prior notification. We never agreed, and we will never seek approval from them to resupply our troops in BRP Sierra Madre. And number two, there was no agreement as to boarding or inspection of our ships carrying supplies to our troops in BRP Sierra Madre.
All right. ADG, how keen is the Philippines with regard to creating an all-encompassing agreement with China, meaning an agreement that would cover the entire West Philippine Sea? Because if we take it one by one, one shoal after another, then that would take quite some time. It might even outlive this administration that has been quite vocal against Beijing.
I think that's the purpose of the code of conduct, which has been under negotiation for many, many years now. That has always been our objective, to have a code of conduct for all claimants in the South China Sea as a large body of water, and also in the West Philippine Sea. So, we don't know how fast that code of conduct is going to be finalized. It has taken some time, and we are hopeful that hopefully soon we will have some developments in that regard.
Right. ADG, we understand that the Maritime Security Council is set to convene sometimes this week to discuss this issue. What key points do we expect to be raised in that meeting?
Well, yes, the National Maritime Council will be meeting later this week. from my understanding, because I have not seen the agenda of that meeting, but based on the pronouncements coming from the Secretary of Foreign Affairs, definitely we will discuss the circumstances behind this incident and what type of response the government will have, no, aside from the filing of a diplomatic protest. So how to move forward from that incident and to ensure that similar incidents now in the air will not happen again.
Offhand, what recommendations do you have in mind that you would actually raise to the council meeting?
I am not a member of the National Maritime Council. It's the Secretary Eduardo Año, who is a member of the NMC. But they could probably consider entering into some form of a guidelines for air military encounters, because in 2018 the defense ministers of the ASEAN adopted in principle a multilateral set of guidelines for air military encounters or game, and the purpose of this is to enhance air safety in light of the projected increased military and civilian air traffic in the region. And I understand the United States and the PRC also agreed in principle on a similar multilateral guidelines. So some type of agreement in that aspect, similar to what we did in 2018, could be considered by the National Maritime Council.
Okay, ADG, let's try to break down to our audiences what this very technical term is, air military encounters. Under this agreement, what do countries actually have to do whenever there are two or more aircrafts from different countries flying in a certain airspace?
Well, Katrina, I'm not really an expert here in these types of agreements, no. But my understanding is that it's meant to lessen provocation on either side, preventing them from conducting in a manner that is that could be considered as a hostile act by the military. For example, in the case of the air incident over the Bajo de Masinloc, the use of flares is not standard among friendly nations. So the use of flares in the flight path of a Philippine Air Force aircraft could be considered an hostile act, no? So these types of provisions, I think, are necessary in order to prevent misunderstanding and miscommunication during flight, because this is not the first time that the PRC has had encounters with other air forces. I understand the U.S. Air Force in DOPECOM and the PRC also have had these types of incidents, and also with Australia. So there's a precedent for this. There are experiences in the past that we could take a look at that can be considered when we possibly discuss such an agreement with the PRC.
All right. ADG, has the Philippines summoned the Chinese ambassador to at least seek for an explanation as to why his home country did what it did?
I don't have any information as to that. I think it's in the mandate of the Department of Foreign Affairs. So maybe the DFA is considering that at the moment, but I have no relevant information.
Right. ADG, last time we spoke in person was during the International Media Conference in PICC. And at that time, I remember asking you a question, which again, I would ask now. How can the Philippines actually counter China's non-kinetic warfare strategies that it has been enforcing in our own sovereign waters and airspace?
Well, among many things that we can do, which we have already done, is the use of the transparency policy. No, the government could have said that, you know, these incidents are isolated and they're not happening very frequently. This is the first time. So we could have chosen not to share this to the public. But because of our transparency initiative, as a means to counter illegal, coercive, aggressive, and deceptive actions by the People's Republic of China, the government decided to expose this incident over the skies of Bajo de Masinloc on August 8, the purpose of which is to publicize and let the public know that these things are happening, and for the international community to come to our support and possibly put pressure on China as well, so as not to embolden them to further doing these things in international waters.
All right, ADG, before we talk about the Court of Appeals decision favoring the National Security Council, let's first discuss how some lawmakers have been calling out Vice President Sara Duterte for her silence in this issue. How important is the second-in-command's opinion with regard to China's incursions against the Philippines?
You know, Katrina, as much as I would like to make a comment on this, I think it's best that this question is answered by the Vice President herself. No, I think she has her reasons for whatever statement she makes to the media, and I think we have to give her an opportunity to share to us her thoughts on the matter.
And do you think that her stance somehow has lowered, or not really lowered, but weakened the Philippines' position with regard to China?
Well, I don't think so. I think the Philippine position is clear. The Philippines' position is strong. We have been asserting our position consistently. We have not wavered in asserting our rights in the West Philippine Sea. And the entire government bureaucracy in particular, the ones under the office of the president, the entire National Maritime Council, the entire National Security Council, are one with the president in his foreign policy in asserting our rights in the West Philippine Sea.
Right. Defense Secretary Gilbert Teodoro earlier mentioned that the Philippines is set to sign several RAA-like agreements with different countries. We already have one with Japan and Australia recently. We signed another one. What else are in the pipeline? We understand that France, New Zealand, and perhaps you can name other countries that are also looking to sign similar deals with the Philippines?
Much as I would like to share that, no, the discussions are currently ongoing and the discussions are confidential in nature, unless, of course, those governments themselves state that publicly. So right now, Canada, we're discussing a RAA with Canada and, of course, France. But there are also other countries that would like to have a similar RAA with us, which unfortunately I cannot disclose right now.
Right. Can you just give us a number as to how many countries are in the pipeline with regard to this RAA-like agreement?
I think it's better that we have the Foreign Affairs Department make that announcement.
All right. As ADG, how soon can we see this RAA agreements signed here, or rather by both countries? Are we looking at as early as this year, within the year, or are we looking at next year?
It's possible that one of the two could be signed within the year. There is a lot of precedent in these discussions. There are many templates that can be used by both sides. I think the one with Japan is a good basis for discussion. That's why we are very hopeful that at least one RAA would probably be signed this year.
We have a lot of RAAs, but our formal alliance only stands, or is at least formalized, with the United States. Why are countries just settling for having RAAs with one another instead of entering something similar to the mutual defense agreement?
I think it depends on the countries themselves on what kind of agreement they would like to have with us. You know, a military alliance is a very heavy step that has to be taken when entering into such agreements with another country. And it is not very common to have military alliances that has collective defense. No, we can only count a few, like the NATO, for example. In Asia, for example, the US only has similar military defense treaties with South Korea, Japan, and the Philippines, and Australia. So it's not very common. It is there, but it's not something that is common across all countries in the world. And it is also a political decision on the part of those countries. So these are very complicated decisions undertaken by governments.
No country so far that have hinted with at least some interest in creating a formal military alliance with the Philippines.
I am not aware of any at this time.
All right. ADG, let's talk about the Court of Appeals' recent decision to junk the petition filed by Jed Tamano and Janila Castro for a writ of amparo and the writ of habeas data. For those who were not actually following these stories, give us a breakdown of what happened there. And of course, I understand that you already had a press conference yesterday.
I think the public will remember this because this was a very big issue last year, around September of last year, when the National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict, NTFLCAC, held a press conference to present Jed and Junila to the public because there were allegations that they were abducted by the military when in fact they voluntarily surrendered to the Philippine Army. And in that press conference, they changed their story suddenly and they pointed to the military. And when they did change the story, they reversed their position from what they signed in their judicial affidavit and all of the statements they have made to the Public Attorney's Office, to the Commission on Human Rights, and to all other government authorities. So we took a position against that and we said that it is not true. And in this program, ANC Head Start, I was interviewed here and I said that we will expose whatever information we may have against the two. And on that basis, Jed and Junila, together with their lawyers and militant organizations, filed a case against me personally and against the NTFLCAC, against me for a petition for habeas data and for against the Philippine Army, PNP, and the NTFLCAC for writ of amparo. And fortunately, the Court of Appeals yesterday saw through the smoke and mirrors and the propaganda coming from the other side and ruled in favor of the NTFLCAC. And if I might quote, the petitioners failed to prove by substantial evidence that they are entitled to the writ of amparo. And also the petition for a habeas data was also junked by the Court of Appeals.
And what will happen now to Jed and Junila? A lot of their supporters, their family members, are quite worried that the government might be vindictive against, particularly because they made several glaring statements against the administration.
Well, there's nothing for them to fear because first and foremost, the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeals itself said that there is no imminent or continuing threat to their life, liberty, and security. In fact, I have seen Jed and Junila come on ANC. Okay, I see them in protests and demonstrations all over the Philippines. Whenever there's a big issue, they're there, and they even went to the Netherlands to speak at a public forum. So the Court of Appeals saw through this, no, through all the propaganda, and saw that they are exercising their full freedoms under the Constitution, and that there was no threat to them from then up to the present. So they are not entitled to the writs of amparo and writs of habeas data. And I can state for the record here, Katrina, that there's nothing for them to fear. In fact, we were the ones harassed by all of these cases that they filed against us.
Okay, quite a strong guarantee there coming from the National Security Council's Assistant Director General. ADG, it's no secret that the NTFLCAC and even other similar or arms of government were quite heavily slammed, especially during the previous administration because of several red tagging incidents, because of controversies linking probably or allegedly innocent individuals with regard to the illegal communist movement or communist insurgency here in the country. What is the council now doing to at least rehabilitate its image to the public?
Well, I think, Katrina, we first have to establish and clarify to the public that this is a different NTFLCAC. The NTFLCAC under the previous administration was under a different leadership. Now it is different, no? For example, we have a new executive director, Undersecretary Jun Torres. The vice chair is now National Security Advisor Eduardo Anyo. I am now the head of the Strategic Communications Cluster. So there has been a change in leadership. And because of that, we cannot expect the NTFLCAC to act the same way. So that's why I made that very clear guarantee a while ago, because precisely the NTFLCAC is under new leadership. And therefore, we cannot be judged for the actions of the previous NTFLCAC leadership. And as clearly stated by the Court of Appeals, there were witnesses presented by both sides. And Jed and Junila were given all of the rights and all of the privileges to bring in their witnesses. They were supported from by lawyers from the FLAG, from the NUPL, from Karapatan. A barrage of lawyers, a group of lawyers were there to defend their position. But despite that, after extensive hearing, the Court of Appeals said that there is no imminent or continuing threat to their life, liberty, and security. So a court of law has already said that there is that they are exercising their full freedoms. So there is nothing for them to worry about. And as I said, we are under new leadership.
Mm-hmm. ADG, how would you describe the policy direction of the current NTF-LCAC leadership? And how different is that from the policy direction of the previous NTF-LCAC panel?
Okay, that's a good question, because the differences now is that, number one, we are actively pursuing a peace process with them. The president is supportive of a peace settlement or political settlement. Number two, the president also issued a amnesty proclamation, which was already concurred in by the Congress and by the Senate. So we are now in a peace process mode, asking them to come and surrender. And in exchange for surrender, they will be entitled to benefits, and if they're entitled and if they're qualified, no charges will be filed against them. And lastly, the NTF-LCAC is also pursuing more of a barangay development program, meaning once a area has been cleared of NPA influence or NPA presence, we're now focused on bringing development to these geographically isolated barangays so that they will be insulated from further NPA influence. So the focus now of the NTF-LCAC is more on peace, amnesty, the peace process, and bringing development to these areas.
All right. ADG, we just have to shift on a slightly different topic, because the 2025 midterm elections is looming upon us already. Secretary Carlito Galvez earlier mentioned that the government is working to dismantle 23 private armies ahead of the 2025 elections. How serious is this threat of private armies, especially during at a heated time during political exercises here in the country?
Well, that is a continuing problem for the Philippines. It's an ebb and flow. There has been elections in the past. I remember there were elections that there were no serious political violence, even during the barangay elections. But I noticed recently, approaching the 2025 elections, that there has been some sort of political violence in Pampanga as early as now. So this is, I think, something that government is seriously taking a look at before the filing of elections, before the filing of candidacy by October, to send a very strong message to the political clans and to the private armed groups that we want to maintain an orderly and peaceful elections, and the dismantling of the private armed groups is a priority of government.
Mm-hmm. And what is the NSC actually doing to ensure that these private armies would be dismantled in time for the 2025 midterm elections? Because as far as we were concerned, the government, even in previous administrations, have been quite bent on trying to dismantle these private armies. And yet, years after, decades after, they still exist in the Philippines.
Well, we have been successful in dismantling many of them. I just don't have the data we have right now. But I remember when I was with the DILG, election violence was as at lowest in the 2022 elections. There was no significant election and election-related violence in the 2022 elections that I can remember, because I was closely monitoring that elections when I was still with the DILG. So really, it's an ebb and flow. I just don't have the data right now. But given what we have done in the past, I think we are now in a better place insofar as peace and security is concerned. In fact, Mindanao has had no major kidnapping incident in the past several years. And the only serious terrorism activity in Mindanao for the past 5 years was the mosque bombing in Cotabato. Beside that, the peace agreements with the MNLF, MILF, and the functioning BARM regional government, and the decimation of the Abu Sayyaf group and the BIFF has made Mindanao, for example, much, much more peaceful than it was before.
ADG, I'm glad you mentioned Mindanao. What about private armies or armed groups in the BARM region? We understand that while the government has been quite active in finally dismantling insurgencies there, RIDOs are still quite common, especially during elections. What is the government doing to settle these issues?
I agree, but in general, Mindanao is much, much more peaceful. Yes, we have had significant success in decimating the New People's Army in Mindanao. Davao region, for example, is completely cleared. We only have some challenges in the Surigao, Caraga region and in some parts of Mindanao. But in so far as the NPA is concerned, they are not as much as a threat. And in fact, they have been decimated. But as to the Muslim groups, the extremist groups have also been decimated, as I mentioned, BIFF, the Abu Sayyaf group, and the Mauti group have been completely decimated, and what we have now as our remnants. But the challenge of the RIDOs, the political clans fighting against each other, again, is another challenge. And this is something that the Office of Secretary Galvez, together with the National Security Council and the different law enforcement agencies of government, including the Armed Forces of the Philippines, are looking closely at resolving.
Mm-hmm. And finally, ADG, on the topic of cybersecurity, we understand that this can also be a national security issue. On a scale of 1 to 10, what would you say is the Philippines' level of cybersecurity as of the moment?
Oh, that's a very difficult question because it's difficult to make an assessment of the entire country. We have significant challenges in terms of cybersecurity, and it is just in the past several years that we have started to understand the severity of the problem. There are challenges both in government and in the private sector, and a DICT-led task force together with the National Security Council is looking at ensuring the security of all government communications, for example, government websites and government portals, to ensure that they are not susceptible to hacking. But even the private sector is also susceptible to these types of attacks. So we are working very closely with the private sector to be able to increase our cybersecurity. This is more important moving forward because the 2025 elections is coming, and it's important for us to ensure the integrity of our elections.
Right, ADG, very quickly, before I forget, Rappler just came out with an article earlier this week citing that a Chinese journalist here in the Philippines has been tagged, or it has been quite established that he is an agent of the communist, of the Chinese Communist Party. Any thoughts or any information, any further information, can you confirm that this Chinese journalist in the Philippines is actually coordinating with the Chinese government that may have some implications with regard to the Philippines' national security?
We're looking at that report from Rappler right now. This was just released over the weekend. We're having our intelligence units verify that report. But I'm not surprised if these things are happening. It is part and parcel of Chinese malign influence and Chinese interference in Philippine affairs. So we're looking at these reports and verifying them, and we'll act accordingly.
With regard to you just mentioned Chinese malign influence. How deep are the roots of these issues in the country as of the moment? Have you traced some of their influence or their soft approaches with regard to certain industries here in the country?
As to industries, that's something that we're working on. But as to the information domain, the information environment, we have seen them actively working through trolls, through social media influencers, through different groups that are pro-China. Mm-hmm. So we see them when, for example, a statement comes from China, these immediately are amplified by local groups, no, that are pro-China in an effort, for example, to induce warmongering or scare tactics in the Philippines. So definitely in the information environment, we see them operating.
And aside from the Chinese journalists, how many other Chinese nationals is the NSC looking into or probing into or monitoring because of their suspicious activities here in the Philippines?
Well, as much as I would like to share whatever information we have, I cannot do so because of national security considerations. But please be assured that the NSC is looking at this very closely because, of course, these are agents of a foreign power and therefore they comprise a national security threat.
All right. ADG, the article also mentioned that this Chinese journalist has been in contact with several government officials, even Filipino media practitioners here. What kind of liability will Filipinos who actually cooperate with their schemes have should the government establish their links with this probable or possible or suspected sleeper agent?
Well, we're currently investigating that right now. And whatever comes out of our investigation and whatever evidences that we're able to collect will then lead to possibly legal prosecution. So we will go where the evidence brings us.
All right. We look forward to learning more about those investigations once you finally have the clearance to share it with the public. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning, NSC Assistant Director General Jonathan Malaya.
Thank you, Katrina. Thank you for having me.